Very good morning, everyone. This is Amit Kumar Singh, and today in the class of operation research, we'll study the concept of duality in the linear programming. So I believe in the previous sessions, whatever we have done so far, we have talked about what is linear programming all about. So when we speak about linear programming is all about formulation of equation. A set of equations, probably I must say. So when we formulate these equations, first thing we need to decide the decision variables. Once we decided the decision variable, based on those decision variables, we write our objective function, and then we write our set of constraints which are important to get that objective function, and then finally we end with non-negativity restriction. Then we end our problem with non-negativity restriction, because whatever values we are expecting, we want the values to be positive. So what happens, there's an alternate approach of solving a problem, that is linear programming problem, by using the concept of duality. So what you can do, understand, like if you see this problem, I'm showing you one problem. Suppose this is the problem. Suppose this is the problem, what you can see. So this is the problem. This problem, what you're seeing here, this every problem is called as primal. Every LPP problem, we call every LPP problem is primal. So whenever you see any LPP problem, that LPP problem, which is called as primal, this primal I can convert into dual. When you see any LPP problem, I call this LPP problem as primal, and this I can convert into dual. This LPP problem I can convert into dual. So when I'm trying to convert this into dual, then this concept is called application of duality. So what we are going to do today, guys, in this class, today we're going to study the concept of duality in the linear programming. So linear programming, whenever you see a linear programming problem, and imagine when you're seeing a linear programming problem, imagine what you saw in the linear programming problem, what you see. Imagine in that linear programming problem, what you see. You saw that problem have too many constraints. Suppose you saw a linear programming problem, and suppose you noticed that this problem has too many constraints. So if this problem will have too many constraints, then probably I need to introduce too many slack or surplus variable for the problem. So if you noticed here I have to introduce one slack variable. So here I'll introduce one slack variable. Okay, so slack variable one. I'll introduce a surplus variable. Yesterday we studied surplus variable. So whenever the surplus variable comes, so you cannot allow that surplus variable to enter into the solution. So what you will do, along with surplus variable, you will introduce one more artificial variable. Now for this constraint, again you have to introduce one slack variable. So if they are constrained, whatever the number of constraint, that many variables you have to introduce. And in case in the problem, if you have a surplus variable, then along with the surplus variable, you have to introduce artificial variable so that it can take part in the basic feasible solution formulation. So whenever you see a problem, so you can call that problem as a primal. So whenever you see a problem, you can call this problem as primal. Now this primal, what you see, now what I can do, I can convert this primal into dual. I can convert this primal into dual. Okay, so when I'm converting this problem into dual form, so that concept, what we are talking about, that concept is called concept of duality. Now, why we need to convert a primal into dual? So basic, you can see basic theory I've written. So basically, you can read little bit on the concept of duality, what I've written. So every LPP, which is called primal, it can be transformed into a dual problem. So that is called dual, which provide an upper bound to the optimal value of the primal problem. So whenever you are trying to convert a primal into dual, then either you solve primal or either you solve dual, you're going to get the same answer. Okay, so your answer is not going to change because of that conversion. The idea of converting that primal into dual is to just to solve the problem easily, just to solve the problem in much more speeder way. That is the intention of converting a primal into dual. Okay. Now, duality is used when the primal contains a large number of constraints and small number of variables. So, guys, this is very important. Now, why we need to use this concept of duality? Why I'm teaching you this topic called duality? So, basically, I'm teaching you this concept called duality because when we use this concept of duality, why we use this concept of duality? We use this concept of duality when the primal contains too many constraints. So if the primal contains too many constraints, then probably you need to introduce too many slack or surplus variable and artificial variable to solve the problem by using the simplex method. And then if you introduce more and more variable, then your iteration steps will become more and more lengthy, more and more complicated. So that is the reason why we need to avoid. We need to think about an alternate way when you have too many constraints for the problem. So when you have too many constraints and smaller number of variables for the problem, so what we do, then at that time what we do, we try to convert that primal problem into something as dual problem. So what we do while converting a primal into dual, so for formulating a dual problem, first the problem has to bring in canonical form. So what is canonical form? This is very important word. So whenever you are trying to solve the problem, whenever you are trying to solve the problem, so whenever you are trying to solve the problem, so what you need to do, first you need to bring that problem into canonical form. What is canonical form? I'll explain. Let me explain what is canonical form. So if you see this problem, if you notice this problem, if this question number, if you notice this problem, what do you mean by canonical form? Canonical form means here, what is your objective function? Your objective function is maxima. What is your objective? Your objective function is maxima. So if your objective function is maxima, then all your constraints should be in minima. So that is called canonical form. Here, if you see your objective function, here your objective function is maxima. So then all your constraints should be in minima. So minima or less than or equal to. So if you see this, so this isn't less than or equal to, but this is not less than or equal to. This is less than or equal to. Now it means that it is not in canonical form. Canonical form means if your objective function is in minima or your objective function is minimization, then all your constraints should be maximization. All your constraints should be greater than or equal to. If your objective function is maxima, then all your constraints should be less than or equal. So that is called canonical form. Okay. So how will I convert this into canonical form? So what I'll do, for solving this problem, the first step what you do before you have to convert the primal into dual. So the first thing you'll write that the given problem. You write that the given problem is not in canonical form. The given problem is not in canonical form. So how you got to know that it's not in canonical form? Because if your objective is maxima, if your objective is max, anyone have any doubt, please write in the chat box. So if your objective is maxima, then your constraint should be less than equal to. So if you see constraint number 2, that is greater than equal to. So that means the given problem is not in canonical form. So that this given problem is not in canonical form. So what I will do first, I'll convert this problem into canonical form. So then in canonical form, what you do, you write the same problem, maxima of z. Maxima of z is equal to x1 plus 2x2 plus x3. So no change in maximization. 1 minute, Manjesh. Sir, I'm in class, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes. Yes, yes, I can see. Yeah. Yes. Yes, sir. Who is this person? Who is it? Okay. Okay, okay, I removed. Thank you. No, thank you. Thank you. Okay. So guys, so this given problem is not in canonical form. How you got to know that this given problem is not in canonical form? Because if you see one of the constraints, you have one of the constraints which is greater than or equal. Okay, so what you need to do, so you just need to write everything in less than equal to. So the first, I write my objective function, simply what is written. It's very easy, guys. So this is one of the very easy thing you'll find. So the objective function here is maximization of z is equal to x1 plus 2x2 plus x3. Then you simply write your constraint. I believe everyone has written down the problem. If you have not written down the problem, please write down this problem first. I'm giving you 2 minutes time. Please write down this problem. So please write down the problem in notebook and pen. So that you will understand whatever I'm doing. Because I'll keep minimizing and all. So then it won't be visible for you. Then you'll feel distracted. So your problem is maximization of z is equal to x1 plus 2x2 plus x3 subject to 2x1 plus x2 minus x3 should be less than or equal to 2. Then minus 2x1 plus x2 minus 5x3 is greater than or equal to minus x, then 4x1 plus x2 plus x3 is less than or equal to 6, where your x1, x2, x3 should be greater than or equal to 0. So this is your problem. So this problem is not in canonical form. So first, whenever you have to convert a primal into dual, you have to make sure that the given problem should be in canonical form. Okay, so now this is, now I hope you have written down this problem. So what you will do, now subject to constraint number one, this is no problem, 2x1 plus x2 minus x3 less than equal to 2, that is 2x1 plus x2 minus x3 it should be less than or equal to 2. Then your next constraint, if you see guys, this is next constraint having the sign called greater than or equal to. You have to convert that into less than or equal to. So very easy. If you have to change the inequality sign, just change the value. So how will you convert this greater than or equal to into less than or equal to? How will you convert that? Very easy. So that 2x1. So that will be 2x1. Minus x2 plus 5x3 less than or equal to 6. So just multiply minus 1. So if you multiply minus 1, so then you can convert that greater than or equal to into less than or equal to. It's very easy to convert. It is very easy to convert a LPP problem. So it is very easy to convert LPP problem where you have greater than equal to sign. To convert greater than equal to sign into less than equal to sign, simply multiply minus 1 with the equation. Okay, so I hope you have done that part. I hope you have done that part. So now I can write this as 2x1. This is 2x1. Minus x2 plus 5x3 is less than or equal to 6. So now if you see your constraint, both the constraints are having less than or equal to sign. Okay, now the third constraint, 4x1 plus x2 plus x3. Third constraint, 4x1 plus x2 plus x3 should be less than or equal to 6. Okay, where your x1, x2, x3 all should be greater than or equal to 0. Means done. Now this problem is in canonical form. So the guys, the first thing what you have to do whenever you see LPP problem, if you have to convert the primal into dual, so the first thing what you have to do, you have to write everything in canonical form. So what is canonical form? Canonical form means if your objective function is maxima, then your constraint should be less than or equal to. Or if your objective function is minima, then all your constraints should be greater than or equal to. So based on that only you can write the problem. So I hope you have understood and you have written them in the form, canonical form. So this is the way how you should do the work. Okay, I believe this part is done for you. So now coming back to the theory part, let me drop this. I'll explain you again once more time. Don't worry on that part. So what happens? Why we are using the concept of duality in the linear programming? Just give me 2 minutes, Gagan. I'll do that again one more time. Just give me 2 minutes. So whenever, what is the concept of duality in the linear programming? So what happens when you're solving a linear programming problem? And imagine you notice that the linear programming problem has too many constraints. If the linear programming problem have too many constraints, then to solve that linear programming problem, you will have to introduce then too many variables, and ultimately the whole process will become very complicated. So what we do normally, you can convert a given problem, which is called as primal, into its alternate form, that is called as dual. Okay, so when you are converting a given linear programming problem into a dual form, first thing what you need to make sure that the given problem should be in canonical form. So what do you mean by canonical form? So if you can see, Gagan, see here. So if you see this problem, the what you see in blue color highlighted, that is your problem, that is called as primal, and that I want to convert into dual. Okay. So if you see the Gagan in this problem, if your objective function is maximization, then your constraint should be less than or equal to. So if your objective function is maximization, then your constraint should be less than or equal to. So if your constraint is less than or equal to, then it is in canonical form. Then there is no problem. So what you have to do, you have to see the problem. If your objective function is maximization, all your constraints should be less than or equal to. If the given problem is minimization, then all your constraints should be greater than or equal to. Given that if you see constraint number 2, it was greater than or equal to. So what you can do, you can convert that greater than or equal to less than or equal to by simply multiplying minus 1 to that. So if you multiply minus 1 to that given equation, you can convert greater than or equal to into less than or equal to. So you have to write the given problem in the canonical form. So if you see, now I've written the given problem in canonical form. Now my problem is in canonical form. Once you're done with that part, then what you have to do? So now what are the changes you have to do in the problem? So first thing you have to understand here when you are studying this, so the first thing is that while converting in dual form, So you have to change the objective function. You have to change the objective function of maximization of primal into minimization of dual and vice versa. What that means, so when you are converting the primal into dual, what this means, it means that if the objective function of primal is maximization, then the objective function of dual will be minimization. Okay, if the objective function of primal is minimization, then the objective function of dual will be maximization. So you have to understand this. So you have to convert the primal into dual. So when you are converting the primal into dual, so what will happen? The objective function will be transformed. Maximization will convert into minimization, or minimization will be converted to maximization. Okay. Next thing, next point you can see, number of variables in the primal. Next thing you can see, number of variables in the primal will be the number of constraint in the dual, and vice versa. The next thing what you need to see that the when in the problem, when you see the next thing, the number of variables, whatever are the variables are there in the primal, they will become the number of constraint in the dual. Okay, or vice versa. So next thing you have to understand that how many variables are there in the primal. So if you see this problem, how many variables are there? Three variables are there. In this problem, how many variables are there? In this problem, how many variables are there? If you see in this problem, you have how many variables? You have three variables. How many constraints you have? Three constraints. So in this problem, if you notice primal, in the primal, you have three variables and you have three constraints. So if you write their dual form, if you see this problem, in this problem, you have three variables and you have three constraints. Okay, so when you write the dual, then your constraint, your number of constraints, then your number of constraint will become the number of variable will here. And your number of variable will become the number of constraint here. So here you can see in the primal, you have three variables. Those three variables are x1, x2, x3. And you have three constraints. You can see those three constraints. So when you write dual, in dual, you have three constraints and you have three variables. So the number of variables of the primal will become the number of constraint of the dual, and number of constraint of primal will become the number of variable in the dual. And if the objective function of primal is maximization, then the objective function of dual will be minimization. And if the objective function of primal is minimization, then the objective function of dual would be maximization. So that part you need to make sure. Now, then next thing, in forming the constraint for the dual. So when you are forming the constraint for the dual, what you need to do, we consider the transpose of the body matrix. What we do while we form the constraint for the dual, so when we are forming the constraint for the dual, then what we'll do, we transpose the body matrix of the primal problem. So what we'll do, we work on transposition. What we'll do, so whatever the values you see, the body matrix, this is your body matrix. So if you notice this, these values are your body matrix. These values are your body matrix. What we'll do, we transpose their values. While writing the variable, we transpose the values. Where if you note here, whatever the coefficient you see, so the coefficient which are attached, whatever coefficient you can see, the coefficient which are attached to your objective function, the coefficient which are attached to your objective function, that will be converted into your RHS. The coefficient which are attached to the objective function, that will become the RHS of the dual problem. And the RHS of the primal problem will become the coefficient of the objective function of the dual. So you will not understand this. Let me write this problem into dual form. You will not understand this theoretically if I'm saying. let me write this problem in dual form. So if you write this problem into dual form, so here the objective is maximization. So here in dual form, the objective would be minimization. Okay. So if this was suppose Z1, this is Z2. Okay. Now, how many constraints are there in this problem? So three constraints are there. So I'm introducing three variables. Those three variables are W1, W2, W3. So because three constraints are there, I'm introducing three variables. Suppose those three variables are W1, W2, W3. You can write any alphabet. Okay. You can write any alphabet. If Kishore is writing, Kishore will write K1, K2, K3. Okay. So it doesn't matter which alphabet you use. So we are studying algebra. So you can study any alphabet. So I'm using W1, W2, W3. Okay. Now what you will do, you just see your RHS. Your RHS in the primal is 266. Your RHS in the primal is 266. So now what you write minimization of Z is equal to 2W1 plus 6W2 plus 6W3. This would be your objective function. This is the way how you will start the problem. So when you're writing the problem in the dual form, so you write the objective, because here the objective was maximization. So that's why here I wrote minimization. Now, so when you write minimization, now how many variables will you introduce? That variable will depend upon the number of constraints. So how many constraints are there? Three constraints are there. To introduce three variables. So let those three variables are W1, W2, W3. So then how you write? You write minima of Z equal to. Now when you write minima of Z equal to, then see the RHS. RHS of primal. What is the RHS of primal? These are the RHS of primal. 2, 6 and 6. So that will become the coefficient of objective function of dual. So you write 2W1 plus 6W2 plus 6W3. Okay. Then you write the constraint subject to. Then you write your constraint subject to. Okay. Then when you write your constraint subject to. Now what would be your first constraint? See like this. So just see this value. Just see your first constraint. So this would be this subject to. Then you write 2W1 plus 2W2 plus 4W3. So this is minima. So this should be maxima. This should be greater than equal. Subject to 2W1 plus 2W2 plus 4W3 greater than or equal to. What will be the RHS? So your RHS will be the coefficient of objective function of primal. So what is the coefficient of objective function of primal? This is one value. This is one value. Clear? Then what is your second constraint? Your second constraint will be this. This will be your second constraint. So your second constraint will be, you can see 1 minus 1 plus 1. Second constraint will be W1 minus W2 plus W3 should be greater than or equal to. Now what would be your RHS? Your RHS will be the coefficient of objective function. So what is the coefficient of objective function for second is 2. Right. Now third one. Now for third equation, what is your equation? Just see the coefficient. What is the coefficient? Minus 1 plus 5 plus 1. You write minus W1. Plus 5W2 plus 1W3 is greater than or equal to. Now, the greater than or equal to what? What would be the RHS? So your RHS will be the coefficient of your objective function. Greater than or equal to 1. That's it. The work is done. So this was your primal. You converted that into dual. So you solving the, I will not ask you in exam to solve this value. You can solve this problem by using simplex method. I know we have done a lot of classes on simplex method. You can easily solve this. So to ask you the answer, that is not I'm expecting from you. You cannot solve this problem first of all by graphical method because three variables are there. So only one option left with you to solve this problem. You have to use simplex method. So I'm not interested to get the answer of W1, W3. What I'm interested just to make you learn the concept of duality. So you should understand how to use the concept of duality. Clear. So here are the my objective is to make you learn the concept of duality. So in when you are trying to solve the problem by using the concept of duality, when you are trying to solve this problem by learning the concept of duality, so this was your objective function. This was your objective function. This is your primal. This is your primal. So when you are trying to convert the primal into dual, what you have to do? You have to make sure on few aspects. First thing that the given problem should be in canonical form. What is canonical form? Canonical form means that if your objective function is maxima, then your constraint all should be in less than or equal to. Or if your objective function is minima, then all your constraint should be greater than or equal to. Okay. Next thing, what you need to see beyond that. You have to see that how many constraints are there. So number of constraint of primal will become the number of variable of dual. Then you will see how many variables are there. Number of variables of primal will become the number of constraint of dual. Okay. So first thing once you are confirmed that the given problem is in canonical form. So in case if the given problem is not in canonical form, if you notice any of the constraint in the given problem, if you notice that any of the constraint of the given problem is not in canonical form, maybe your objective function is maximization, but your constraint is having greater than or equal to inequality sign. So you can convert that greater than or equal to inequality sign given greater than equal to inequality sign into less than equal to inequality sign by multiplying that with minus 1. So if you multiply that with minus 1, automatically you will convert the given set of equation by changing its sign very easily. Once you've done that part, then we'll write the dual form. So when we write the dual form of the equation, what we do in while writing the dual form of the equation, if the objective function is maxima, we convert that into minima. So when you wrote that objective function as minima, then you have to write the variables. That variables depends upon the number of constraint of primal. So then the coefficient of the objective function of the dual will be the RHS of the primal problem. The RHS of the constraint of the primal problem will become the coefficient of objective function of dual. And then the RHS of the constraint of primal will become the coefficient of objective function of dual, and the coefficient of objective function of primal will become the RHS of the constraint of the dual. Okay, where the constraints, where the number of constraint of dual depends upon the number of variables of the primal. And the number of variables of dual depends upon the number of constraint of the problem primal, and the number of variables and the number of constraint of the dual depends upon the number of variables of primal, and the number of variables of dual will basically exactly the number of constraint, and the number of constraint of dual will be equal to the number of variables of the primal. So based on that ideology, you can construct a dual problem. So this is the way how you need to do. I hope this part is clear for all of you. Okay, let me write down one more problem. Let's do one more problem. So problem number two. So find the dual of the following LTP. So maxima of z is equal to 3x1 minus x2 plus x3 subject to 4x1 minus x2 less than equal to 8. 8x1 plus x2 plus 3x3 is greater than equal to 12. Then 5x1 minus 6x3 is less than or equal to 13, where x1, x2, x3 are greater than or equal to 0. Write down the dual form, guys. Everyone, write down the dual form of this LPP problem. Everyone, try this. So I believe by this time everyone would have got the answer. Now, if we see this problem, so in this problem, the objective function is, if you see in this problem, the objective function is maximization. So all your constraints should be less than or equal to. So if you see this constraint, it is less than or equal to, fine. But this constraint is greater than or equal to. So it is not in canonical form. This constraint is less than or equal to, this fine. So now first thing what I'll do, I'll convert this given problem into canonical form. So what I'll do, I'll write in the equation. I believe you have written down this problem. So I'll go down. So then I'll solve this problem. I'll write the given problem is not written canonical form, the given problem is not written in canonical form. So what I'll do, I'll write in canonical form. So the objective function is maximization of z is equal to 3x1 minus x2 plus x3 subject to constraint. So if you write in canonical form, you write 4x1 minus x2 is less than or equal to 8, then this constraint is greater than equal to. So how will you convert the greater than equal to less than equal to? Minus 8x1 minus x2 minus 3x3 is less than equal to minus 2. Okay. I'll do here. So I'll write this as minus 8x1 minus 8x1 minus x2 minus x3 is less than or equal to is minus 3x3 is less than or equal to minus 12. Then 5x1 minus 6x3 is less than or equal to 13. Then your x1, x2, x3 should be greater than or equal to 0. I believe everyone has done this work. Anyone doubt till now? Anyone doubt till now? I believe everyone has done like this. So if you notice in this problem, you have three variables. But if you see in equation 1, I have written only two variables. So 4x1 minus x2. If you see the equation 1, I have written only two variables, 4x1 minus x2. I have written down only two variables, 4x1 minus x2. So what I can do, guys, I can write this in the form of x3. But I know x3 does not exist. Just for my simplification, what I can do, I can write this 4x1 minus x2 plus 0x3 is less than or equal to 8. I don't think that it's going to affect my answer. Just to avoid any kind of confusion. Similarly, if you see the third constraint, third constraint is 5x1. Third constraint is 5x1 minus 6x3 is less than or equal to 30. So what I can do, I can write x2 with zero coefficient. So I can write this as, third as 5x1 minus 5 0, doesn't matter, you put plus or minus. So 5x1 plus 0x2 minus 6x3 is less than or equal to 30, where your x1, your x2 and your x3, they should be greater than or equal to 0. And now if I want to convert this into dual form, so this given problem is called as primal. So if I want to write in dual form, the same thing I'll apply. So if I want to write in dual form, I can write this in the form of dual form. So in dual form, what I'll do, I'll write my objective function as minimization of z. Suppose this is z dash, this is z double dash is equal to. Now guys, kind of revision for you. Now, how many variables are there in this problem? Three variables. So the constraint will be 3. So if 3 variables are there, then for dual, the constraint would be 3. How many constraints are there in the primal? 3 constraints. So then the number of variables here would be 3. number of variables would be 3. So I'm writing W1, W2, W3 is greater than or equal to 0. I'm assuming the number of variables here are W1, W2 and W3. How you got 3 variables of the dual? Because 3 constraints were there in the primal. Okay. Now, once you got the variables as 3, those 3 variables are W1, W2 and W3. Now, what you will do? You write your objective function. So when you're writing the objective function, then what coefficient you use for the objective function? So that is the RHS of the constraint of the primal. So what are the RHS of the constraint of primal? They are 8 minus 12 and 13. So you write minimization of Z is equal to 8 W1 minus 12 W2 plus 13 W3. So this is your objective function. Subject to. Now what you will do, you write your constraint. Because 3 variables are there, so you have 3 constraints. So what are the coefficient of those 3 constraints? Here this is 4, this is minus 8 and this is 5. So the variables of the constraint are 4, minus 8 and 5. So you write 4 W1 minus 8 W2 plus 5 W3. Here what is your objective function? Minimization. If your objective function is minimization, then all your constraint will have greater than or equal to sign. Okay. Now, what is the RHS of dual? So RHS of the dual is the coefficient of the objective function of primal. So what is the coefficient of objective function of primal? For the first constraint, what should be the RHS? So that should be the first coefficient of the objective function of primal, that was 3. Okay. Similarly, I'll write for the 2. Similarly, I write the second constraint. See this. 4W1. Plus 8W2 plus 5W3. Second, you will write here the sign is minus. If you see here the sign is minus. So for the second, you write minus W1. And 0 W3 greater than or equal to. See these values vertically. See these values vertically. Here, so here if you see this value vertically, this is minus W1 minus W2 plus 0 W3 is greater than or equal to. Now what would be the RHS of the dual? So the RHS of the dual for the second one would be what? Second one, if you see the sign, what is the value here? The value is minus the value is minus 1. See the RHS. Very good. Same thing for the third constraint. So if you see the third constraint, see the value vertically. See the value third constraint. So that would be W01 minus 3W2 0W1 minus 3W2 minus 6W3 0W1 minus 3W2 minus 6W3 greater than or equal to. So what would be the RHS? See the constraint of the objective function. That is 1. Done. So this is your dual form. So you have converted the given primal into dual form. Now, if you write this much, you will get the answer. Or otherwise, if you write this much, this is more than enough. Here you see the RHS is having minus 1. So many authors, what they do, they go one step further. They write this as minimization of Z is equal to AW1 minus 12W2 plus 3 plus 13W3. They write this subject to 4W1 minus 8W2 plus 5W3 is greater than or equal to 3. Then they'll write this as W1 plus W2. Anyway, no need to write 0 and all. 0 I simply wrote for your clarification, because you have to write vertically. Then minus 3W2 minus 6W3 is greater than or equal to 1, where W1, W2, W3 should be greater than or equal to 0. So many books, they write the same problem like this. Because normally, mathematicians don't like RHS with negative sign. So you know that how to change the sign of a inequality. That you know very well. If you multiply minus 1, you can change the sign of the inequality. Clear, everyone? Anyone have doubt? Fine, I hope you understood this. See this next problem. So suppose the objective function is minimization of Z is equal to 2x2 plus 5x3. 2x2 plus 5x3 subject to, constraints are x1 plus x2 is greater than or equal to 2, then 2x1 plus x2 plus 6x3 is less than or equal to 6, then this is x1 minus x2 plus 3x3 is equal to 4, where x1, x2, x3, they are greater than or equal to 0. Suppose this is the problem. Last problem, guys. first equation acha for this I think for this problem you tell first equation clear है ना I hope you have seen this okay now see this problem now if you notice in this problem so this is x1 if you notice in this problem this is x1 minus x2 plus 3x3 is equal to 4 so if you see something like this so x1 minus x2 plus 3x3 that is equal to 4 now what you can do you can write this equation into two part so this equation can be x1 minus x2 plus 3x3 is greater than equal to 4 or it can be x1 minus x2 plus 3x3 is less than or equal to 4 please see this so if your equation is x1 minus x2 plus 3x3 is equal to 4 so you can write that equation into two part so you can write this equation into two part you can write this as x1 minus x2 plus 3x3 is greater than or equal to 4 or it can be x1 minus x2 plus 3x3 is less than or equal to 4 I hope this is clear with everyone now if you see the objective function here is minimization so if your objective function here is minimization then all your constraints should be greater than or equal to so all your constraints should be greater than or equal to so this is in greater than or equal to this is in greater than or equal to now to save time I could have written there but I because you people are running behind time so I can write this equation as minus x1 plus x2 minus 3x3 is greater than or equal to minus 4 clear na so now I can write this was your given equation so this equation I have break this equation to two part I have broke this equation to two part this is one part this is your one part this is your second part and then because your objective function was minimization so I have to write everything in greater than or equal to so that's why this I have written like this I hope this is clear with everyone so let me quickly go to the question so now what I will do so here now this object function this question is not in canonical form So write this in canonical form. That is minimization of z. Here, if you notice, three variables are there: x1, x2, x3. So I can write 0x1 plus 2x2 plus 5x3 subject to your constraint are x1 plus x2 is greater than or equal to 2. Everything should be greater than or equal to. Then minus 2x1. Minus x2 minus 6x3 is greater than or equal to minus 6 and then third constraint would be your third constraint x1 let me write it down x1 minus x2 plus 3x3 should be greater than or equal to 4 and then minus x1 plus x2 minus 3x3 greater than or equal to minus 4 where x1 x2 x3 all should be greater than or equal to 0 that's it So now what I've done, I've written the given problem into canonical form. So I've written my given problem into canonical form. So this is now my primal. So this is my primal now. Okay, now what I'll do, I'll convert the primal into dual. I'll convert the primal into dual. So when I write converting the primal into dual, so I'll write maxima of z is equal to. So how many constraints are there? 1, 2, 3, 4. There are four constraints are there. We'll introduce four variables: w1, w2, w3, w4, greater than or equal to 0. Because four constraint is there, this is your primal, which is written in canonical form. This is your dual. So you write w1, w2, w3, w4 greater than or equal to 0. Now maxima of z. What should be what should I write the coefficient of dual of the objective function? What should we write the coefficient of objective function of dual? So just see the RHS of primal. Just see the RHS of the primal. So the RHS of primal are 2, minus 6, 4, and minus 4. So you can write this as 2W1 minus 6W2 plus 4W3 and minus 4W4 subject to now do the same work here. This is 1, this is minus 2, this is 1, this is minus 1. So how many variable you introduce? 4 variable. So how many constraint you write, that depends on the number of variable. So 3 variables are there, so you write 3 constraint. So the first constraint will be, your first constraint will be w1 minus 2w2 plus w3 minus w4. Here objective function is maximization. So this will be less than or equal to. So what will be your first RHS? What will be your first RHS? 0. Second constraint, so that would be 1 minus 1 minus 1 plus 1. Second constraint is w1 minus w2, w1 minus w2 minus w3 plus w4 less than or equal to 2. Now for the third constraint, there's nothing written here. This is 0. Okay. This was 0. This is 6, minus 6. This is 3. This is minus 3. So you can write 0W1 minus 6W2 plus 3W3 minus 3W4 is less than or equal to 5. So now you have written them in the dual form. Now you have written them in the dual form. Is this clear, everyone? Now you have written them in dual form. Now if you write this much, your work is done. Or if you notice on W3, W4, they are same. W3, W4, they are same. If you see them, they are same. They are like something like this. If you notice W3, W4. They are same. Like you can write, I can write a variable. Suppose I am writing a variable called W5. I can say W5 is equal to W3 minus W4. If I see, they are always with minus sign. They are having same value. If you notice, W3 minus W4 in all. So I could have written this problem as maximization of Z is equal to 2W1. Sorry, maximization of Z is equal to 2W1 minus 6W2 plus 4W5. Because if you notice, W3 minus W4 is same everywhere. They are having same coefficient. So I can simplify this. I can simplify this equation. I can make it more simple by introducing a variable called W5. So where W5 is equal to W3 minus W4. Okay, so I can write maxima of Z is equal to 2W1 minus 6W2. And here if 4W3 minus 4W4. If you take 4 common, you get W3 minus W4. So in place of W3 minus W4, I can write W5. Subject to W1 minus 2W2 plus W5 is less than or equal to 0. Then second one, W1 minus W2 minus of W5 is less than or equal to. Then minus 6W2 plus 3W5 is less than or equal to 5, where W1 and W2 are greater than or equal to 0. Where W1 and W2 are greater than or equal to 0. But what is W5? W5 is unrestricted. Right? W5 is unrestricted. You cannot determine the value of W5 because W5 is W3 minus W4. Where your W5 is W3 minus W4. This is the way, very easy thing. It's not at all anything difficult. So LPP in duality problem, you just need to know how to write the equation, how to convert a primal into dual, or to convert that in form, in canonical form. So where the number of variables will become the number of constraint of dual, where the number of constraint of primal will become the number of variables of dual, where the objective function of primal, that is maxima, will become the minima of dual, and if the objective function of primal is minima, that will become the maxima of the dual. Okay, so you have to write in such a way where when writing the coefficient, we apply the logic of transpose, where the coefficient of objective function of primal will become the coefficient, will become the RHS of the constraint of the dual, where the RHS of the constraint of primal will become the coefficient of objective function of dual. So all these things, we have done lot of problem from last 1 hour to make you understand this. In case of any doubt, you have full right to watch the recorded version of the class, which will be sent back to you very soon. So you can see them, and I hope all your doubts will be cleared. So, Shruti, I believe you're sending me the attendance by this time. So, Shruti has sent me the attendance. So, guys, anyone want to ask anything before I wind up the class? Okay, what I will do, that 2LPP problem, 2LPP simplex problem, what I told you to do, which came from the previous year question paper, I don't know how many of you have done or not. So what I'll do, I have done in my notebook. I'll take the photo of that problem and I'll send you, so that you will refer that in future. So I know how much I'll tell you, you people not gonna study. So I'll send you that in your group. So I hope that will serve the objective. So keeping that intention, I'm winding up the class. Anyone want to say anything before I wind up? Okay, so nobody is saying anything. So I'm assuming that you have understood whatever I have done till now. So guys, thank you everyone. Take care of yourself. See you next week. Take care, everyone. Bye.